My name is Stanislaw Robert Liberta with AV Ultra, and in this lesson, we're going to be talking about rotoscoping in Apple Motion. In previous lessons, we've talked about masks and how to use them to reveal text and titles, how to do screen and sky replacements, and in this lesson, we're going to be taking masks one step further. Let's take a look at the completed example. I have a little bit of text. I have that being covered up. I have this coffee cup being put down on this table, and then it reveals my rotoscoping text. The way that this is built out is originally I just shot this at a coffee house. So you can see I've got this in focus and everything else is kind of blurred out. Then I have a second piece of footage that I shot in my kitchen. And what we have done is we have cut out the coffee cup and this arm and combined them together. The way that this is done is with a traveling mat, or you think of it as an animated mask. I've also color corrected this and color balanced it to make it match our scene a little bit. Rotoscoping can be very, very intensive. It can be very meticulous kind of work. So we're not going to be going through the entire example in this lesson, as it would take a few hours to do so. Let's go ahead and get started. If you open up our 19 Rotoscope start, you're going to see a few different layers. We have our overlay, and then we have our roto cup and our background plane. And in our background plane, we just have what we're going to be compositing in, and we're really focusing on this roto cup. In this roto cup, you can see I have a few different filters that I've already placed. You can ignore those for right now. And what we're going to really do in this section is mask out this cup as it's moving. Turn off these filters really quick. When we've worked with masks before, what we've done is we've just gone to our Bezier tool and we've created a selection to cut out. So in my case, I'm cutting out this cup. And there we can see the cup in our scene. However, that cup is only cut out in that one specific frame. If we want this to be continually cut out from frame to frame, what we need to do is we need to animate this mask across time. Now, I could just use this mask, but I highly recommend against that. There's a few different reasons. The first reason is if I am just trying to mask this from frame to frame, I'm not going to see exactly where everything begins or ends. So as an example, I can't really turn down the opacity of the mask very easily. Because it's just a Bezier mask, it's just affecting the whole layer. So that's not something I want to do. Secondly, if I'm taking this whole arm and this coffee cup and trying to do it all in one mask, things are going to get really messy really fast. Especially as I come down forward here, our mask is going to be a completely different shape than this coffee cup. So what we want to do is we want to use several different shape layers to rotoscope properly. So in my case, I'm using a shape just for the arm and then just one for the hand, the fingers, the fingertips, and the cup separately. We're going to go ahead and get started with just making a shape for the cup. And so I'm going to take this and just make a pretty rudimentary shape. Another thing I'm doing too is I'm reviewing through the footage to see exactly where everything is going to be on the scene at once, the most complicated part. So for example, I have fingertips, I've got a cup, I've got a hand, I've got an arm, I've got a table. This scene right here has most of the stuff that I'm going to want to cut out. And I've closed that shape right away, and I'm going to go ahead and rename this, and I'm going to call this cup. And we're actually going to put this in its own layer. Now we have this group, and I'm going to call this roto group. And I'm going to take this whole roto group, and I'm going to turn down the opacity. And I can see right away that I'm not perfect when it got all the way up here. This is absolutely something that I'm going to want to go back and fix. So I'm going to go back here really quick and just edit these points. Because again, I want this to be as good as possible as I'm rotoing through. Otherwise, it will create problems for me down the road. And I'm just reviewing all of this to the very corners. And right away you can see, because I'm using a shape layer on top, it's a lot easier for me to kind of work with this and see how this is going to be looking once I'm done with this. And I'm holding on to Alt Option just to move one tangent instead of the other. That is my one frame that I've rotoscoped so far. Now, if I come to my shape and my geometry, you're gonna notice I have all the points I made. When we're rotoscoping, again, if we did this whole hand, we would probably have like something like 50 different points. We don't wanna do that. We wanna do this in sections. So I'm gonna go ahead and just create a keyframe at this point. And I'm also setting a marker. So you can see I've got a little marker here that says Roto Start. And I'm going to take all of these points. So I'm going to take my selection tool, edit points, and I'm going to highlight all of those. And I'm just dragging it into position. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump ahead 10 frames. I'm going to hold on to shift and press the right arrow. And I'm going to drag all those again. And I'm going to do that again. 10 frames. And I can see that at this point, the cup really doesn't move too much. It doesn't really change. So I don't need any more keyframes for this cup at this time. When I'm at this final keyframe for the cup, I'm going to zoom in and just make sure that everything is where it needs to be. And I can see that some of my points work, but some of them don't. So I'm going to go back into my edit point, click off of there, click back on, and move my individual points to cover all this. And when I'm doing this, I'm animating this shape. Eventually, I'm going to use this shape along with a few others as a mask source. But by breaking it up like this, I can really fine tune things down the road. A couple things you want to keep in mind, more keyframes, more problems. So you want to have as little keyframes as possible, but you also want them to be as precise as possible. There's going to be a little bit of wiggle room with some matte magic that we can have. But for the most part, what you see is what you get. So you really need a good mask to use. As an example, let's jump back where we first started, and I'm going to move back 10 frames. And I'm going to go ahead and select my edit points and select all these items again and just try to get them to fit. You're going to notice that it's slightly off again because the hand is changing shape, things are kind of moving. So we're going to choose our edit points and I'm going to move them one at a time to cover my cup. You want to be very careful. So you see how I just did that right now is I moved the whole section. What's happening here is this is changing the transformation properties in the regular properties tab. And we don't want to do that because what that will do is it will throw off all of our keyframes. You want to make sure that you don't move this. This isn't changing any of the shape control point data. It is moving the whole transformation, which will throw off every single one of your keyframes. So you want to make sure that you're moving just these control points. And you can see as I'm moving this control point, my point two in my inspector is moving back and forth. And I'm going to go back another 10 frames. And the reason why I'm going through 10 frames is because it gives me a good range of motion right away. And I'm going to select my edit points, select all of them. And now that I have them all selected, notice how all my points are changing in my inspector. Hit shift and click this one, move this over. I'm just dragging these off because they're not even visible on the screen. Selecting these, back another 10 frames, and it's no longer in the scene. So I'm going to select all my points and just drag it off. Now I'm going to go back halfway point. So I'm going to go to 5 frames. And here I can see the cup still isn't there. So I want to see where the first frame of that cup really is. And that's here. I'm at frame 1 second and 20 frames. And I'm going to select all these points. Just drag them to where that cup begins. So now I've got these benchmarks and it's creating a pretty good range of motion. Here's my next benchmark and I'm going to go another 5 frames. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I can see it's not really fast enough. So I'm going to need to go in there and say, hey, let's go ahead, grab all these and place them here. So now if I go back a few frames, that's holding on a lot closer. Now I want to fine tune this again. So I'm going right at the 2 to 3 frame mark. And I'm going to drag all of them again. They're still all selected. And now I have this nice range of motion and we'll do the same for this. So again, at this 5 frame mark in between this keyframe and this keyframe, selecting all my control points and just scooting it over. And now I'm at 2 seconds and 4 frames. I'm going to go over 5 more frames. And I can see that's pretty good still. Right here where the cup is being put down, I'm going to want to adjust those. And realistically, I'm going through almost every single frame to make sure that it is all lined up right. Now that I have this cup, I would go ahead and make a whole new shape just for this arm. So I would do just this point. We'll scoot this over. And now I would make this a whole different color, just so it's not confusing. So this one I might make green. I'll absolutely need some extra points here because people's arms aren't as rigid as a paper cup. And I'll do the same overlapping this section with this hand to about here. And then I'll do maybe the fingers or even just the fingertips separately. Here's a quick time lapse of my whole process for rotoscoping. Now that I've completed this, and you can review this in the 19 rotoscope end, you can see all the individual pieces that I've made. Here's my arm, and then here's the wrist to the fingers. I have all the cup and then the individual fingers. So if I play this back, really we've isolated that hand and arm completely. Once we've built these shapes, what I was able to do is use this whole shape layer as a group, as an image mask. You can see right in through here, I kind of softened it up a little bit. And the way that we did that was a little bit of something called matte magic. And matte magic will take your matte and will shrink it down and kind of smooth and feather it off. So this lets me kind of smooth out some of the edges, much like our feather controls in our other mask examples. So I'm going to zoom that back out. I also went ahead and created a shape just for the table. I found that if I didn't have that table and I just had that coffee cup, it didn't look as realistic because I couldn't get the shadows just right. So I just put this same table in here. And if I need to, I could add a bit of a tint to make this match a little bit better. Lastly, what I did here was I actually colored my hand to match the scene. So this is what it looked like beforehand. Obviously, this was shot in two different places at two different times of day, and it looks very artificial. This is very blown out. There's not a lot of color in the hand here, where all of this in the background is very rich. I've added a bit of a color balance. I defocused it a little bit, added some levels and some brightness to try and match it into the scene just a little bit more. Once I have this shape, I can use the same shape as I did before to mask out this area, but then our text as well. So I'm using this AV Ultra tutorials in my text, and I'm having it masked by that shape, and then that layer stops, and my rotoscoping starts that also has that same mask. So that's a way that you can put words behind things if you wanted to kind of reveal some text. One thing to note is another reason why we wanted to make this shape is if I wanted to work in another program, or if I'm working with any other editor, if I just rotoscope this out with a mask, I can't really output that very easily for other editors. If I have this rotoed shape by itself, this I can give to anybody and they can put on that same footage, color balance it, and maybe After Effects. They can continue to work with it and it's still going to cut out the same exact way because it's the same footage. So that's the basics of rotoscoping in Apple Motion. Again, my name is Stanislaw Robert Liberto with AV Ultra. Thanks a lot for watching and hopefully you found this useful.